Good morning, good morning. Welcome to service this morning and happy Father's Day to all you fathers today. Because it is Father's Day, we will not have service here tonight, so you can take that time to spend with your dad. Also, we will not be having a prayer meeting this Monday night either, and donuts for dads. Attention all men, after the service, please go to the fellowship hall for a cup of coffee and a donut provided by the youth department. We'll have a VBS volunteer get-together. That's going to be June 24th from 5 to 7:30 p.m. It's going to be for those who have volunteered to sign up or anyone who would like to help sign up. A meal will be provided along with child care. And Vacation Bible School will be July 10th through the 14th. It's going to be Stellar Shine Jesus Light. There are sign-up sheets in the foyer, so please sign your kids up. And also, if you would like to help, sign up there too. And now Brother Gary's going to come around and address the people.
You are addressed. All right. Amen. Good morning. Happy Father's Day to everybody, to all of our men. And to those of you that are not a father, we celebrate our godly men also too. So we're so thankful for the opportunity to be here this morning. We do have one graduate we want to recognize today. And we're going to, as the church does, we present a Bible, really nice Bible. And, to the graduate, and it's going to be CJ. So if you'll come up here this morning, I need somebody to get a picture. Come on up here, young man. Put you right on the spot. Right, okay. Congratulations, brother. Congratulations. Yeah, okay. Yeah, get a picture real quick here. Everything's got to go with social media. Hold on, let me get this. Hold on right here. Amen. And that's from the church, and this is a little something from Sister Kim and ourselves, and congratulations. We're praying for you, buddy. God bless you, man. Okay, buddy. God bless you. And CJ won't say this, so I'll say it for him. If you want to give him some money because he graduated, then give it to him. Amen. All right. It's the only opportunity you're going to get like this, to people hand you money for graduating high school. So, but we are proud of this young man and proud of our young people. And we thank God they're back there today and having children's church. And we're thankful for them, their ministry there. So at this time, Sister Jennifer is going to come do our announcements. God bless you, brother.
Praise the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. God is good. Our Heavenly Father, we're going to celebrate Him this morning. Amen. We wanted to continue for CJ, keep him in our prayers because he is going into the Navy soon. We'll be leaving us soon. So proud of him. But we're going to keep you in our prayers as a church and as a church body. Amen. Glory to God. Our prayer request this morning, Sister Angie Respa says, remember Sarah Gray. She's having knee surgery on Wednesday. She's in a lot of pain this morning and is asking for a prayer cloth. So let's not forget before we leave this day to get a prayer cloth for Sister Sarah Grace this morning. Sister Teresa Mobley says, remember Carolyn Moore had a stroke, and also Mrs. Keeling fell and hurt her back. So we need to lift those up in our prayers this morning. Let's remember Sister Sylvia Liverman. She's not feeling well. We've been missing her. So let's keep her in our prayers continually. And also my mom's been sick this past week and still not feeling well today. So let's lift her up in our prayers this morning as well. Are there any others you would like to raise your hand to represent this morning to bring before the Lord? Amen. Let's go into prayer, trusting, believing, and expecting to see God's word fulfilled. Hallelujah.
Would you stand this morning? Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we're going to worship the Lord together. I'm glad you decided to come to the Lord's house. I'm glad you did. I'm thankful you did. But you know, we're here today to meet our Savior and our Lord. Amen. We're here today to experience Him, to have an encounter with God, and to draw closer to the Lord today. I don't know about you. I'd like to draw closer to the Lord today. Amen. Would you go to the Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, we bless you this morning. We thank you, God. We take this opportunity to come and to intercede and to pray, God. These needs have been lifted up. There's so many more, Lord, that over the past few days and weeks and months, we've been lifting up before you, people battling cancer, people facing surgeries and hospitalizations, Lord God. But we're so thankful tonight that you're a God that hears and answers prayers. And so look down to this service today, Lord, and we pray that you will hear. We'll have your ear today to hear these needs lifted up. Now take this service, Lord God, and mold it into what you would have it to be, Lord. Take our young people, our youth services going on down there, Lord, and we ask you to bless the staff and the young people, Lord, and these songs that'll be sung and the praises that'll be lifted up, Lord, the word of God that'll be preached in a few minutes, Lord. Let everything bring glory and honor to you. Now, Lord, help me to do my part this morning. I've come to worship you. I've come to praise you and I've come to magnify. Let the people of God rejoice. This is the day that the Lord has made and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. Would you remain standing? Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen.
Why am
and mercy. Sing along with us.
Living saving a sinner like me. To tell the world that salvation is for free. There were times in my life that I just did not do right. But you watched over.
Grace and mercy came along and rescued.
sing that chorus one more time before we quit. Amen. Let's sing it together, church. Oh, help me sing, church.
Your grace and mercy brought me
through.
I'm living
right here by the grace of God, with the help of God, right here. Thank him right now. Oh, I want to thank you, God. Yes. Oh, I'm going to praise you. Oh, praise you, God. Hallelujah. Seated just a second. Amen. I will sing that the rest of the day. Amen. What a beautiful song. I also wanted to recognize the remainder of our graduates at this time, and I hope I don't miss no names up here, but Emily Aldrin Buck, granddaughter of Marion Alligood and the late Steve Alligood, daughter of Stephen Kevin Alligood, graduated from Southside High School. Ellis Caden Culliver, a son of Ellis and Ashley Culliver, grandson of Randy and Cheryl Moore, the late Ann Moore, and also our grandson of Gene right here. And Annie Ruth Culliver, great-grandson of Ellis and Lily Bell Woolard, Horace and Wilma Moore, and Herman and Goldie Culliver. He is graduating as salutatorian, I hope I said that right, from that means he's really smart, from Northside High School, class of 2023. He also, at the same time, graduated from Beaufort Community College with his associate's and arts degree. He has been awarded the Northside High School Male Scholar Athlete of the Year Award, the Math Award, the Platinum ACT Work Keys NCRC Award, the ITW Foundation Scholarship, ECU Alumni Association Legacy Scholarship, ECU Chancellor Scholarship, the Reed Sassnett Memorial Scholarship, Bella Little Mason Scholarship, Ponzer Ruerton Club Scholarship, Jimmy Hodges Memorial Scholarship, and the Optimus Club Scholarship. He will be attending ECU in the fall to pursue a bachelor's in mechanical engineering. And if you need any money, go see him. Amen. Great. I know they're proud of that, and it's okay to read all that. Amen. We're proud of all of them. Amen. We have already mentioned CJ, he's graduated and he'll be heading to the Navy. We thank you for your future service. Now, I'm sure I'm going to mispronounce this, but and Sister Karen's not here this morning. I don't see her, but if I mispronounce their grandson, Eli Hunan, grandson of Karen Ayers, graduated from Northside, Megan Amelia Murdoch, granddaughter of Marion Alligood and the late Steve Alligood, daughter of Marcy Alligood and Lee Murdoch, graduated from Northside. Dylan Nicholson, grandson of Lori Baker, graduated from Beargrass Charter School and will be attending Williamston Community College for industrial electrician. And Mariah Waters, daughter of Amber and Randy Latham, and Timothy Waters, granddaughter of Yvonne Waters and the late Melanie Ball and Aaron Waters, graduated from UNC Chapel Hill with a bachelor in exercise science. So we've got some high-achieving people here. Amen. And we wish them the best. And I tell every one of them, put God first, follow God, and he will lead you an exciting and amazing life that you'll be able to look back at and say, wow, isn't God amazing? Amen. We're going to take the offering up at this time. We still got the buckets up here. We are going to, I promise you, we're going to transition back to our usher that's going to hand it out. But we got so used to this during COVID time. And so the buckets are up front. They're in the back. I want to say again, we're going to be intentional in our giving. We give to support the work of the Lord. We give because we love God. We give because we know that you can't outgive the Lord. Come on and say amen. We support missionaries all over the world. We support home missions here. We support needy and families in the community and all kinds of amazing things that the ministry of the Alley Good Church of God does. And we couldn't do it without your sacrificial and intentional giving. God bless you. Would you stand at this time? Let's pray over the offering. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the many blessings that have been bestowed. Lord, I look and think about all these precious young people graduating and embarking out on a new journey in their lives, Lord God. We pray a special prayer upon them too, Lord God. You will order their steps, direct their paths, oh God. And Father, we just pray over this offering, Lord God. Let it go out and meet the needs of the community, the world, the people, for the furtherance of the kingdom of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And thank you for blessing every one of us. And all the people said amen and amen. God bless you as you get out of the seats and come and let's give in the offering this morning.
Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. It's wonderful to thank the Lord for blessings and the blessings of our fathers. And if you had a godly father, which I was very blessed to do, he was a very strict godly father. And I probably got more spankings for talking in church than anything else because Daddy had all the rules down, you know, the black and white rules. We didn't have any gray rules at my house. And one thing that he didn't tolerate was you messing around in church. So I always was like, oh, I hope I didn't talk too much tonight. He didn't spank me often, but when he did, I remembered it. But I'm grateful today. He actually was buried 8 years ago this week. And so Father's Day always reminds me of him in the sense of his passing. But as great as my dad was to me, and he was wonderful, it's nothing like my Heavenly Father. But I'm glad that God gave us the example of fathers who love us, protect us, care for us, provide. And our Heavenly Father does it so much better. We don't have a special singer today. We were going to be honoring graduates and that kind of thing. So you're the special singers this morning. And we're going to just sing one of our, it's a very traditional song. But if you just think about it, it's such a song of ministry and praise and thanksgiving. And it's just entitled Amazing Grace. And I think it's just a great sermon. And if you feel like standing, I know we've had you up and down a good bit today. I call it exercising my hinges as I get up and down. As I'm aging, I need to kind of move the hinges a little bit. So it's a little exercise there. But let's sing This Is Unto the Lord and think about what you're singing. And just so grateful today for that amazing grace. Hallelujah.
God. Come on, church, let's worship
Praise God.
One more time, lift your hands and praise Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God.
Come on, give Him a hand clap of praise. Would you remain standing for the reading of the word, Psalm 78. Happy Father's Day. Happy Godly Man Day to you. Amen. I want to celebrate not only our dads today, but all granddads and uncles, guardians, and those men who are an example to this congregation, whether you had children or not. What a godly, precious commodity godly men are. Come on, say amen. What a precious commodity godly men are. The word of the Lord reads in verse 5, "For He established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children." Don't move yet. A testimony and a law for the nation of Israel that they should make them known to the children. Verse 6. The generation to come might know them. Listen. Even the children which should be born. In other words, the psalmist is talking about even youngins, and I say youngins, youngins that have not even been conceived yet, which should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children. So the youngins that ain't even been born, we got to teach the ones that are here that they'll teach that next generation, and that next generation will know the testimonies and the laws of God. Verse 7, that they might set their hope in God. Come on, church, all our hope is in Him. Without Him, we are in trouble. And forget not the works of God, but keep His commandments. Heavenly Father, bless the reading of the word. Touch me, your servant. I got to have your help, Lord. And you've never let me down. You've never disappointed me. I have failed you, but God, you've never failed me. And Lord, today, not only for my help and my strength, but for the congregation this morning as we celebrate a beautiful holiday, a wonderful celebration of godly men and godly fathers. We ask you to help this congregation to receive the word of God and apply it to our hearts. In Christ's name, everybody said amen. God bless you as you're seated. Thank you, Sister Ellen. Amen. Amen and amen. Let's go back. I want to read that scripture again. The word of the Lord reads in verse 5, "For He, God, established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers," those that went on before us, "that they should make these testimonies and these laws known to their children." Verse 6, I'll read it again, "that the generation to come might know them." Now, let me help you out today. I don't know how many children are back there this morning. Last Sunday, I think Brother Zach, our youth pastor, said we had 30 kids back there. They're not back there playing games. They're not back there, we're not entertaining them. We know what a serious obligation that the church has, and that is to teach young children about the things of God. Come on here. to do just what this Bible verse said, that and that they might know him, but even the children which should be born. I love that that's the way God looks at things. We can only see, you know, if you have a grandchild, you see that little grandchild and you think, oh, that's so beautiful and so cute and you love that child. But God is saying not only think about them, but the children that will come, that they will bring into this world and their offspring. Brothers and sisters, men and women, fathers, guardians, grandparents, foster parents, adopted parents, whoever you are, those that are called to lead, amen, we have an awesome, awesome responsibility to declare to those that come after us what thus saith the Lord. Come on and say amen. I'm telling you right now, we're raising a generation. There is a generation, not we raising, but there is a generation coming up. They are as confused as a termite in a yo-yo. Don't know up from down, in from out, what is truth and what is not truth. Let me tell you something. God's word is never going to change regardless of what the generations that come behind us. We'll stand on the word of God. We'll be judged by the word of God. When we're all said and done and we're gone, heaven and earth has passed away, the word of God remains forever. Come on and say amen. So let's go on to verse 7 and I'll go on here with this sermon this morning. That they might set their hope in God, a nation of children, a family, a generation that would turn its back on God's known commands, that would turn its back on the things of God, has no hope whatsoever. I don't know about you. Hope is a precious commodity. I look in the at my young teenage daughter, and my hope for her is that she will live a godly life. My hope for her that God will send her a godly man that loves God. And when she gets married at age 37, hope's a precious commodity. My hope is that you do well. My hope is that all of those children that are there and in this building this morning, my hope for those children is that God will use them in a mighty way. I was going to have a tender moment with my daughter on Father's Day today, and she blew in and blew out of my office, and happy Father's Day, and went on out, and she come back in. I'm thinking, oh, she's going to come back in. We're going to have a tender moment. She grabs her phone and walks out. But I wanted to tell her, and I will later, being your dad brings me some of the greatest joys that I've ever experienced. Being a dad, and I love being a dad. I enjoy it. It's one of the greatest joys of my life and my two grown sons. And I remember, there's two poignant moments that I remember. Many memories over the years of things that I've shared with my children. My oldest, when he was 4 years old and we were out in the yard and I was playing catch with him with his little plastic glove and bat, and he came up to me and I kneeled down and he looked at me with his beautiful little eyes and he said, "You're the greatest daddy in the whole wide world." I said, "You're right, son." And another, not too long after that, another moment that my youngest son, now Sean would have been 4 or 5 then, or 5, and my youngest son was a toddler, and I'll never forget, I worked long hours, I commuted, I was working 60, 70 hours a week, and I had to commute an hour one way to work, and work 6 days a week, so I was gone a lot, unfortunately, doing what I had to do to support my family, and just what we do. And I remember coming home, and my son, youngest son, had a little T-shirt on and had his diaper on. He might have been 16 or 18 months, and he was a chubby little guy. And when I opened the door and he saw that it was his daddy, his little legs began to pump, run in place. Both arms raised up, big grin on his face. And it's those moments like that you realize how important it is to be a dad, that somebody's looking, that next generation is looking to you for love, for guidance, for support, for protection. Come on and say amen. And not only with all of these things that are so important, how I take care of my family as a dad, and how I protect them spiritually and physically, and how I provide for them and all and love them and do all of those things. The most important thing that I can do so that they'll have hope for their future and hope for the next life, amen, is to teach them the Word of God. Come on and say amen. I'm going to tell you right now, it does our hearts good. Sister Jennifer alludes to this quite often from the pulpit, that how the children will ask deep and hard questions. Sister Kim helps teach the little bitty ones, and they'll ask prayer requests for the craziest things. You have any prayer requests, little Johnny? Yes, help me to find my little plastic spoon I lost. I wish I'd have wrote some of them down. Some of them are hilarious. Y'all better watch out what y'all say. They'd be requesting, you know, pray for my daddy that he'll stop hollering at my mama. Don't it, baby? We y'all, you know, that's why what I'm preaching on is so important. What we have is an opportunity we don't get. And many of you that have grown children like I do, you realize how soon they're out of your house. You realize how soon that little baby, you're changing diapers and holding in your arms and taking care of every need that he has, how soon he's driving a car. How soon they're graduating high school, CJ. How soon they're out the door in the Navy, graduating and getting married and gone. So what we do now is lay that foundation that we have an opportunity. And the Bible tells us to do that. Not only for them, you know, and CJ, I don't mean to embarrass you, and I won't. But I pray with your children's children will know what God taught you. That what's been instilled in your life as a young man will be broadcast and cast down and carried on generation after generation. Church, listen to me. We're living in a time and an age where truth has become whatever it is convenient for you. You believe your truth, I'll believe my truth. You want to believe that, that's fine. I'll believe that. You believe any. Listen, I want to stand on what thus saith the Word of God. So there'll be hope for them. This generation we've got coming up behind us, if they don't turn to God, there is no hope for them. We've got to be careful how we lead, because our children are watching us. I tell a story. A man went golfing with his, and I believe that the story was the grandson. It could be son, grandson. He's one little bitty fella. 3 years old, he took him along. He wanted to teach him and show him how to play golf. And, you know, I took, and I'm a terrible golfer, and I'm not a golfer, but I just play sometime at tournaments to help out fundraisers for churches. I am a terrible golfer, so don't nobody think I'm a golfer. But I used to take my son out on the golf cart, and if you're not careful, they'll run, leave you behind with the golf cart. And so little Johnny, whatever his name was with his granddaddy, and he's about three, and granddad thought it was a great idea to teach him the game of golf. And so for a year or so, and then finally grandpa buys him some golf clubs and little bitty golf clubs, and there's a big July 4th picnic together and all the families there, and they tell little Johnny, go out there and show us what you've learned from grandpa on the golf course. He goes and grabs a golf club, says an ugly word, and throws the golf club in the tree. I played with some of them too. But we have to be careful how we lead by example. Don't you think they're not watching? Don't you think that when your children go visit other church family members and hang out with them, they're not seeing and coming back and saying, wait, well, you know, this and that. Don't you think that they're not watching the way you worship? Come on here. I know y'all tired of me talking. I'm not going to keep apologizing for being a Pentecostal. That's who we are. I love all of God's people. I love all of God's churches, whether they be Baptist or Methodist. And I don't know what your background is and where you come from. But you, if you're visiting today, and we're glad you're here, by the way, if you are visiting. But you're in a Pentecostal church. And I need to tell the home folks this. We worship the Lord around here. And I want our young people and our children and our teenagers, amen, to see that you and I worship the God of all creation. And we worship Him like we really mean it. That we worship Him like we are worshiping the God that His grace and mercy has brought us out. We worship Him like the God of amazing grace. We worship Him like the God who is our Redeemer, our Savior, our soon coming King. Can anybody help me in this house this morning? Anybody know who I'm talking about? That's the God we worship here. Don't even get me started about the way we praise. We sing song, oh, praise the Lord, all ye people. Come on and shout aloud His praises to proclaim. I'm going to probably mess it up. With every shout generation, with love and adoration, praise your holy name. Come on and pray. I'm going to do it by myself. People sit there like you stuck to the seat. You stick there like you've been singing that song all your life and you act like you don't know the words. It kind of goes like this. Praise the Lord, all ye people. I want us, look, if I can go to a ball game and scream to the top of my voice because my little Johnny has scored a point, amen, I ought to be able to come to the house of God and praise the God that saved me out of the pits, amen, and lifted me up so I don't have to die and go to hell. You say, Brother Bateman, I'm telling you, amen, let's show them that we know how to praise the Lord and we're not ashamed of who we are and who we are in Him. We got to make sure we lead by prayer. And our prayers can't always, God help us. It can't always be, God, well, you know, God, I bought this car I can't afford, and so help me to have grocery money for next week. Y'all ain't gonna help me. We gotta show them that we turn to God in the good times and in the bad times. That we serve a God that's God on the mountain, about the song said, and He's God in the valley. I want my youngins to see when things are bad, amen. I want them not to, I'm not calling the governor up. I'm not going to try to get a representative. I'm not against psychiatrists or psychologists or anybody that helps anybody. I'm for all of that that helps us to be sound physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually, amen. But I want my children and I want our children to see that when we need God to move, we go to God in prayer. It's not a program. It's not a mechanism that we build in the church. It's something that we do as a lifeline directed to the throne of God. Would you say, man? They gotta see how we lead. Man, you know, if we ever needed a time, we always have, but I keep saying that over and over. But we need a church that knows how to lead in a dark and a spiritual crazy world. This church, and we're not bragging on a church. It could be any church, but got to have a church where there's people that know how to pray. There's the preaching of the Word of God. The true Word of God is going out where we have leadership in the church that not afraid to confront. Come on here. You know, you don't, if you're out in sin, you don't want me to come by the house and tell you to, you're okay, just keep coming to church. Now, you want somebody to stand flat-footed and said, repent, son. Y'all ain't with me. Come on here. People, we don't like to be confronted. We don't like to be, we don't like this kind of preaching confrontational. We want people to tell us how wonderful everything is. We want people to get up now in the pulpit and say, true love is when two people love each other, don't matter who. Come on here, y'all help me now. I'm going to tell you right now, we want men and women of God that are in leadership of the church and those that God has appointed to be leaders in the church to lead the biblical way. Come on and say amen. That's what these scriptures are talking about. God's laws, God's testimonies, and God's commandment. So there's some hope for the next generation. We got to show them how to, listen to me, parents, grandparents. They're watching us, how we treat one another. Come on, and not if you're not parents, they're still watching the adults, how they treat one another. If I make my wife mad, and that's a common occurrence in the Bateman household, I aggravate her. But if I do, I'm careful. I want my, and I'm rarely wrong, but when I'm wrong, I'll apologize. And so I want, and my daughter has learned this. I know y'all tired of my stories. That's the only ones that got. I don't live at your house. If I come stay with you a month, I'll have plenty of stories. And so my daughter has learned that I don't apologize much, but when I do, I mean it. And so when she's upset with me, something I've done or whatever, she said, apologize. And I'll apologize. She said, you really mean it? I said, I really do. She'll hug my neck and we'll move right on and put it behind us. Come on here. I'm showing, and I know I've told you this, and I know you're tired of it, but here again, I'm modeling my behavior. I am far from perfect. I have far from got everything that's, you know, that I do everything the right way, never make a mistake. I'm far from that. Everybody in here knows that. We're all human. But I've made my mind up. I'm going to model how a godly husband should treat his godly wife. I've made my mind up to do that. And I want my daughter to see she ain't going to have no young man with no belt and his pants hanging down to here. Y'all, are y'all like me when you ride by somebody like that, you want to holler out the window, pull your pants up. The only reason I don't do it because I don't want to get whooped. But I want her to expect. I want her to see. And see, I don't play dating. Y'all get mad if you want to. Dating's not in the Bible. And that's why there's so much messed up stuff with the young folks, because we send them out there young like that. Hormones are right. Y'all ain't going to help me. And we're living in the most sensualized, sexualized society that has ever been in the world and ever in time history. We're living. They've got access to more stuff, and we just send them out. So I don't believe in dating, and my daughter's not going to date. I'm saying that. Hello, YouTube. Hello, Facebook. She's not going to date. It's not biblical. Brother Larry, somebody help me over here. He had three boys. He don't know what he's talking about. So. Thank you. Why should I let my 14, 15, 16-year-old girl leave in a car with somebody I barely even know, disappear from my sight, and stay gone for hours? You say, well, you should have done a better job of raising him. Honey, go back to when you were 16. So what I'm trying to say here is I'm setting up, I'm instilling into her and what we have to do our young people. And I know a lot of people don't like when I do this because it messes them up. They don't like, well, I don't care what you believe. I'm not asking you. I'm doing what I believe is right for my family. And so what I'll do then is that when there is a young fella that she's possibly at some point, I know how it works, y'all. She won't even know who I am. I'm going to say, well, you bring him here to the house. And as he comes in the doors, I'm cleaning out the shotgun. I'm going to establish from the very beginning, daddy is crazy. Daddy will hurt you over baby girl. Now you do what you have to do. And I'm telling you right now, if we don't instill this in them, these godly principles, I want my daughter to see what a godly man does with a godly woman. Come on, help me say amen. Because they're teaching them that anything goes if it feels, y'all, come on here, if it feels good, you can do it and there are no implications. I guess I'm preaching to the wrong crowd this morning. Show them how to treat mom or wife or grandmama. Teach them how to honor their father and mother. Now I'm going to go today. You may think this is weird. You already think I'm weird. That's okay. I know I am. I'm going to my daddy's grave this afternoon after lunch. I'm going to take a chair and I'm going to sit out there, Brother John. I'm going to sit out there by my daddy's grave. I know he's not there. He's with the Lord. But, you know, that's the only connection I got now with my daddy. His body's in that grave. So I'll be close. You say, boy, that's, no. Some of y'all had loss. Y'all know what I'm talking about. And I'm going to sit there for a few minutes and with my wife and my daughter and think about and talk about memories and some good times and all. And I'm doing that because I'm honoring my dad's legacy that he left me. He got up every morning. I'm closing. Come on, Sister Ellen, please. He got up every morning and went to work. Every Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night and every revival and every church meeting, my dad took us to church. My dad provided for our family. He was our spiritual leader. He was our physical leader. He was the one that led that family. Was he perfect? No, he wasn't. He taught me how to treat a woman because I saw how he treated my mama. So today, when somebody rides by and they see me sitting out there, they're going to think, well, that's odd. I know people do it, but they'll think, well, that's odd. I'm doing that to honor my dad because of the influence that he had over me. And the strict... Some, you know, my dad was tough. He had four boys. Thank God he didn't have a daughter. She'd still be unmarried today. He was strict. You know what? I appreciate it now, though. I do. You don't have to agree with me with what I'm saying. I was 19 years old. I'm closing. I hope. I'm 19 years old. I appreciate you teenagers being here today. Some of you probably don't have no choice. That's good. But I appreciate you teenagers, and we got more in the back. There was a rule in my dad's house. If you lived in that house, you went to church. When I got 16, 17, 18 years old, the last place I wanted to be was around a bunch of shouting, praising, worshiping people. I thought y'all all were crazy. And I was still home at age 19. I know I should have been gone, but I was. I guess I'd gone a couple times, come back. I was 19, right at 20. And I had a, won't go into it, but I had a rough night the night before, out doing things I shouldn't have done and didn't feel good that morning. Dad come in my room. Said, son, get up. We got to go to church. You know, I'm feeling myself. I'm 19. I'm going to bow up. I ain't going to make it today, Pop. I called him Pop. I don't feel good. I ain't going to make it today. Next thing I know, I was airborne. Dangling like a cluster of grapes. See, that bowing up stuff's over with now because Daddy could probably whip me even today. He was a big, strong, muscular man. I know, I didn't get that gene. As he held me by the collar, he said, son, you're going to church today. I said, yes, sir. and I chafed under that, and I couldn't wait to get out of the house, you know, and get away from that strict regiment, that strict upbringing. And always, every time we have, he didn't shove it down my throat, but anytime there were problems that I came to him or he was trying to address my life and the way I was living, it was always undergirded with biblical principles. Because he knew my only hope was in God. Come on here. I want you to stand. I'm sorry, Craig, if you'll put that back, that last verse back up again. I'm sorry. God said, I've set my testimonies, my commandments, my laws. I want this generation here that's listening. I want the next generation, those that not even been born, so that they'll have hope in God. And keep his commandments. Now, I had to make my own personal decision for the Lord to come to God. And it's Jesus who saved me. Come on. But I can tell you, God used a godly man, a dad, to help point me in that direction. And when I came to the Lord as a young man, what was a fractured, really bad relationship with my dad instantly turned into one of the most wonderful relationships I ever had. He was my mentor, my friend, my dad. I was pastoring my first church. Them folks was kind of like y'all. They were driving me crazy. I said, Dad, what's wrong with these folks? He said, Son, we all have our ways, and you got them too. Little nuggets of wisdom. I could have used him about 2 years ago. I want you to bow your heads and listen to me. I'm going to pray over this prayer cloth. We're going to give this.